I love, I don't know, something about how we're laid out in the room. It feels like there's more of us today. It feels exciting. We had a really fun time at Norwood Community Day yesterday. Hopefully we'll have some pictures later in the announcements. Jim taught me how to make balloon animals, which is fun. I tried to make an octopus, but it came out kind of everywhere, so it's fun though. Did anyone, by show of hands, did anyone go to Norwood Community Day? Right, cool. Yeah, so you know, let's try to stay the church engaged. But I do want to welcome you this morning because you came, hopefully seeking something from God. I don't know why you woke up early. I don't know why you got out of bed to come here. But for some reason, you wanted God to speak to you. So I pray that happens. I pray God shows up directly in front of you and speaks a word to you this morning. Let's pray now. God, we come before you in Jesus' holy name, asking you, Lord, for your presence. It's really the only thing we need, God. Lord, help us not to be satisfied if we just sit in our own routine, Lord. Help us to open our hearts. Help us to seek you, Lord. You say that if we knock, the door will be opened, God. Those who seek, find. And if we draw near to you, you will draw near to us. Jesus, we need you to draw near to us. Help us, Lord, prepare our hearts and minds for us to draw near to you this morning, God. Thank you that you are all around, and we just ask that you would speak a word to our hearts today. Thank you, God. Praise your holy name. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's start with a hymn. We have the organ today, which is exciting. Please turn with me to hymn number 595, I Give All to You. From God, and so what we have on loan. I give yourselves of your time, of your energy. If you'd like, there are boxes by the exits for you to drop off an offering as you leave. And also, please give yourself. So after the service, please speak to someone who you wouldn't normally speak to. Just introduce yourself. Ask them how their week's been as a way to offer yourself to God by offering yourself to another person. So let's pray over this offering. God, we thank you for what we have. We thank you, Lord, that you are in control. And Lord, we ask that you would help us to enter into your ministry, enter into your kingdom, Lord, and give back to you, know what to do with what we have, know who we are, Lord, what we have to offer the world and to each other, Lord. Help us to give up ourselves, Lord. We give it all to you, and we ask that you would bless us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you.
instruments to it. It's just gorgeous. So we have announcements. Let's do the slideshow. We have that ready. I want to show the announcements of yesterday. Do we have that queued up? We do not have that queued up. We will have a slideshow for you next Sunday with pictures of balloon animals. An announcement for this Saturday. Do you want me to make it, Sally, or do you want to make it for the consignment center?
No. Tell about the sale.
I'll take this down. We have our consignment sale on Saturday from 9 to 1. We could use some help. I'll be here every afternoon and evening. We will be setting up and tagging clothes and things like that. If you'd like to help in that way, we'd appreciate it. We need help about 1:30. Quarter to clean up from the consignment sale. And so anything you could do, we would appreciate. Then in the evening, we have our trunk or treat from 6 to 6:30. I know we're missing some trunks. I think Pat usually has a very elaborate trunk. She goes all out and decorates her trunk and everything, but her daughter's getting married the next day, right? Mm-hmm. So Stephanie's getting married on Sunday, so I don't know that Pat will be there with her car and her trunk. But if you would like to come and hand out candy to the kids in Cavanaugh's parking lot, come about 5:15 so we can line you all up. And it's a lot of fun to see the kids. We handed out a lot of flyers yesterday, actually all of them. A few blew away, but we handed most of them out, and people were very interested in the trunk or treat. So if you can't help us out that night, coming here and handing out candy, we need candy. So if you would like to bring some candy over to the church and drop it off, we'd appreciate it. So we can have enough to hand out to everybody. And come to the sale. Tell your neighbors about the sale. Anybody who has kids or has grandkids, let them know, because there's a lot of good bargains. We're getting a lot of stuff in. We also have a Christmas corner and Christmas decorations. So if you need any Christmas decorations, you want to give any gifts, we do not have a supply chain problem with toys or anything like that. So if people are concerned, they may be able to find their toys here. Okay, so see you next week for that.
Great.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I'm going to try to summarize that. That was amazing information. I was trying to take notes. But this Saturday, 9 to 1, we have our consignment sale. There's going to be a Christmas corner that's down in the lower sanctuary. We need help. I'm just repeating it so that people online can hear me. We need help every next week. Around what time?
We'll be here probably till 8 each night.
Okay.
Yeah.
So from like 6 to 8?
Yeah, anytime. I mean, we'll be here from the afternoon into the evening.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of work being put into this.
There's a lot that goes into it, yeah.
Yes. Many hands make light work. So
right.
Please, let's pitch in. If you are able to, just come on over. If you're able to let Sally know beforehand, like, hey, I'd like to volunteer for Wednesday or Thursday, that'd probably be good for her to have a what's up, heads up. And you said 1:30, is that to tear down? 1:30? Yeah. And also, if you're able to volunteer the day of, I mean, come out in the morning of and the day of to meet our neighbors, to meet people in the community as they look through stuff. And at 1:30, we need hands to tear down. Then, at 6:30, we're going to have our trunk or treat in the parking lot of Cavanaugh's, but come to the church.
6 o'clock.
Sorry, 6 o'clock. 6 o'clock, we're going to have the trunk or treat. Come to the church at 5:15. So that we can get organized. It's a whole day. We'll probably spend the day just at the church, maybe grab pizza or something. So mark off your calendar this Saturday. Let's do some community outreach. Let's show our Norwood, our neighbors, that we care and we're there for them. Thank you. Thank you so much. Does anyone else have any more announcements? We go to the group. I want to announce announce that we are having an amazing time at Bible study on Wednesday. It's a really beautiful, intimate group at 7 o'clock, and it's just been fun to get to know each other on deeper levels and get into the Word and watch the videos and have our conversations. So please come join us. We're right in the back parlor, right behind at 7 o'clock. It's been fun for me for the past two sessions, so you're welcome. All right, that's the announcements. Thank you, everyone. Let's hear now in the scripture as God speaks to us through Amos. Amos 5, 10 through 15. Listen now to the word of God.
You hate the one who reproves in court and despise him who tells the truth. You trample on the poor and force him to give you grain. Therefore, though you have built stone mansions, you will not live in them. Though you have planted lush vineyards, you will not drink their wine. For I know how many are your offenses and how great your sins. You oppress the righteous and take bribes, and you deprive the poor of justice in the courts. Therefore, the prudent man keeps quiet in such times, for the times are evil. Seek good, not evil, that you may live. Then the Lord God Almighty will be with you, just as you say he is. Hate evil, love good. Maintain justice in the courts. Perhaps the Lord God Almighty will have mercy on the remnant of Joseph. May God bless these words. Amen.
Thanks be to God. We'd like to hear from each other, joys and concerns. What are the small things, the big things that are happening in our lives? Anything good happened this week that we can celebrate? Yes, Kurt.
Yeah, Jenny and I and Bill and Jane Hutchinson went down to see Noah's Ark. And if you ever had the opportunity, it is awesome. It really was. We spent a whole week from Monday and returned late yesterday.
Do we have to start preparing for some rains? You would let us know.
They actually have the animals, but not on the ark itself. On the ark itself, they have animated. But they have the real animals that were on the ark on a separate thing that you can go pet them and everything else.
That's awesome. It's really so, a good time.
Yeah, it's located in Warren, Kentucky.
Great. Thank you. Anybody else have any joy? Any little thing good happen? Don't be shy. You're one family. How was your week? What happened? What about concerns? Anything that we can pray for together? It's okay if you said it in the previous week. It's still on your heart. Raise it up. It's okay if it's a small thing. Yes?
I just want to lift up my brother Bob.
Definitely. No problem. He's a good member of the church, so we definitely are praying. Thank you. Anybody else? I'll continue to lift up Bill's mom, also Jennifer. All right, last chance. It's not really the last chance. That's why I was listening. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you, God, for being a present, living God, someone who we can speak to, God. Wow. Thank you, God, that we don't have to go through anyone, that we go through Jesus. But Lord, we can just speak directly to you and be heard by you. Praise you. What a blessing, what an honor to be able to speak to the Creator. And so, God, we speak to you about everything on our heart. It's also just amazing that you don't care how small or big it is, Lord. You want all of us. You want to be involved. And so we give it to you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for a good time at Noah's Ark, God. We thank you for the good times that we have with partners and friends. Lord, we pray for Bob, God. You know what's going on, and we just ask that you would be with him, God, surround him, in Jesus' name. We pray also for Bill's mom, Lord, bring healing and strength to her, bring emotional support, be with her. Pray for Jennifer, God, healing, Lord, encouragement, God, Holy Spirit, just surround her. And for everyone else, Lord, I know there's thoughts on their hearts and minds, and so I don't know what they are, but you do, God, and you hear them, Lord. Help us to just trust you with them. Help us to trust it to our family, our church family. And we just ask that you would answer our cries, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your holy name. Let's all say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Disciples were even more amazed said to him, "We have left everything to follow you." "I tell you the truth," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, and with them persecutions, in the age to come eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first." The word of the Lord.
Who do we serve? Who do we serve? I think to tease this out, we have to look at where our time and our treasure lies. When I was thinking about this, I started thinking about how much time I'm spending with my house, with my finances, with errands around town. And I came to a conclusion. Sometimes the things we own end up owning us. I am now a new homeowner, and I spend a lot more time and energy than I ever have worrying and thinking about my house. Just this week, I went into the basement to try to fix the water heater. It was, it was last week, but it was cold water for showers. It's not fun. And so I thought I could figure it out. I went down there and pressed buttons and read instructions and pressed more buttons. I was way out of my league. And so after an hour or two, I called someone. After a few hours, he came. After a few more hours, he figured it out. Anyways, it was a lot of time and energy spent figuring out the water heater. You know, there was a maintenance person before in my life that I called, and now I guess that's me and whoever I can call. So it's sometimes requires our time and energy, you know, the things we have, the responsibilities we have as adults, even as young people, we can sometimes get kind of sucked into all of this. And sometimes, if we're honest, it takes our time away from God. Sometimes we can spend a whole day and at the end be like, "Oh, did I speak to God today? Let me get on my knees. Let me talk to God." I mean, it's a very busy world we're living in. And we have a lot of stuff on our mind, things to think about. And so sometimes the things we own end up owning us. Today, a rich young ruler runs up to Jesus, falls down, and kneels before Jesus, and asks, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, to understand this passage, I think we have to imagine this young man. First off, this man has got everything. He's got the nice house, he's got the nice car, he is set. But it still feels to him like there's something missing. There's something in him that is just not filled yet. And so I think we can kind of understand that no matter how much we have in this world, there's going to be something missing if we don't have a personal relationship with the one who loves us most. I think that's a beautiful lesson already from the text. If we don't have a personal relationship with God, it doesn't matter what else we have, there's going to be something missing. And even if we're Christians and saved, if we don't have an active relationship with Jesus, if we're not picking up the phone, if we're not praying, if we're not in the scripture, it's still going to feel like there's something missing. You know, it's like if you haven't called your mom or your kid in a few months, or your best friend in a few months, you're going to feel that missingness. I would encourage all of us to just keep that active relationship so that we can fill that hole. And so he kneels before him, humbled, right? He's a rich young ruler, but he's not too proud to ask for help. He realizes that there's something missing, and so he humbles himself before a very poor person, kneels on his feet before the very poor Jesus, who doesn't have where to lay his head. And he asks this homeless man from Nazareth, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus' response is awesome. It it's great. Jesus responds and says, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone." And I love that Jesus is always more committed to the person right in front of him, to addressing, why are you using these words? Why are you coming at me like this? He's not trying to make a correction or a perfect point. He's not trying to say, well, technically I am God, so you're right. No, he says, why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. I think that's beautiful because, you know, he's concerned with this guy. Why is this guy in front of me calling me good? And I think in doing this, he's saying to this man, let me show you why. Let me show you why you're coming to me for this, why you're kneeling before me, and why you're telling me good teacher. I think Jesus is a mirror, like a mirror that you see in the morning. I think Jesus is a mirror to everyone who comes before Jesus, honestly. I think Jesus shows us ourselves, why we're using the words we use with Jesus, who we are. And praise God, because I think we all need a mirror. I think it's a beautiful thing for God to be in our, you know, to be a human like us and show us ourselves. And so I think that's what Jesus was doing. He wants to challenge and encourage and guide this young man to the truth. He's not satisfied that the young man calls him good. He wants him to call him good for the right reason, right? And he wants him to call him God. At the end of the day, he wants him to get this, that, hey, I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am God in front of you. So he asks him, why are you calling me good? Only God is good. Why are we approaching Jesus, I think, is something we need to ask. You know, let's read ourselves into the text. Are we approaching Jesus? Are we falling before him? And are we asking him for the things of our heart? Or are we just calling him good and trying to, you know, boast him up? Jesus doesn't mean that. What words are we using? Are we being open and real with him? Are we recognizing that, look, you're the only one, Jesus, that really can give me what I need? Or are we just kind of using the church language that we use? Thank you, God, for this and that. No, I think we need to figure out, like the rich young ruler, why we're using these words, why we're here before Jesus. Why are you in church? Why have you come? Is there something inside you that's missing, that needs God this morning? I think so. I know there's something inside me that aches, and it leads me to prayer. It leads me to church. So why? It's humbling to remember that, you know, as Jesus tells the young man, no one but God is good. I think it's nice to remember that none of us are good. That's nice. Let's get that out of the way. No one in this church is good. It's kind of a relief off your shoulders, right? You don't have to keep trying and trying and doing to get eternal life. No one is good but God alone, and God has given us eternal life. So let's remember Jesus' response to him. Why are you calling me good? No one is good but God alone. I think that's a second lesson that we can take away. And so in today's scripture, Jesus keeps going, trying to show this man a mirror to himself. He asks him to go through a checklist, right, of the good things done. He says in verse 19, you know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother. And the rich young ruler is like, great, I've done all that. Yes. I imagine he's like counting down his finger. Yeah, haven't done that. Haven't done that. Oh, good. I'm getting an eternal life. I've done all the right things. And, you know, Jesus says something difficult. After he says, teacher, I've kept all these since my youth. Jesus in verse 21 says, you lack one thing. Right? But before he says you lack one thing, the scripture, the Bible says that he looked at the man and loved him. Which is beautiful. I'm so glad that's in our scripture today. It says, Jesus looked at the man and loved him. After he said, hey, God, I've done everything. I've checked it off. I've been a good rich young ruler. I've done it all. Jesus looked at him. His heart ached. He loved him. and said, "You lack one thing. Go sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." Is what Jesus said to this young rich man. And let's remember through the rest of the sermon when Jesus first looked at him and loved him. His heart is breaking with love because this man wants to be close to Jesus. Jesus can feel it, right? This guy is coming before him, still probably kneeling down. He wants to be with Jesus. And he's still kind of far away. Jesus can feel it. Jesus tells the man that he lacks something. Everyone else around him looks at this man and envies him. We say he's got the car, and that, well, he doesn't have a car, but he's got the horse and a nice house. He has his all. So people envy him, but not Jesus. Jesus doesn't envy him because he has it all. Jesus loves him because he doesn't have it all. Jesus loves him because he lacks one thing. This young rich ruler lacks one important thing. The thing he lacks is a heart fully and totally in service to God. Who do you serve, Norwood United Methodist? Who do you serve? Where is your heart? Where is your time? Where is your energy? Jesus asks him to sell everything he owns, give the money to the poor, gain real treasure in heaven, and then follow Jesus. Serve the poor, the brokenhearted, the unclean and unfit. Sister and brother, who do we serve? The scripture says the rich young ruler is shocked. Whoa. Sell everything. Whoa. And he walks away grieving, crying maybe, because he can't bring himself to sell everything. I mean, maybe half of everything, but everything? He can't bring himself to lose everything he's worked so hard for. He can't bring himself to become poor. Just to follow and serve Jesus? Is it worth it? In his mind, is it worth it to become poor, to follow Jesus? He is sad because it seems like he's not going to fill this hole inside. And it's sad to me because he decides to walk around with that emptiness. He said, you know what? I'll just deal with it. I'll just walk around with this empty feeling inside myself. I think if we're honest, sometimes we do that too, right? We just, you know what? I don't know where God is in this, but I'm just going to walk around. I'm going to handle it. I'm going to work overtime. I'm going to make sure I'm good in a few years down the line. We just, you know what? We'll handle it. We're alone, we got this, we can do it. This man walks away, accepting this hole inside him. And I pray that we stop doing this. I pray that if there's something aching inside us to be close to God, I pray that we stop everything, we sit down at our workplace, in our kitchen, and just pray and say, God, I need you to fill this hole. This young ruler is rich and sad because he can't bring himself to give up this world. He can't bring himself to give up this world to be part of a heavenly one, to be part of a kingdom of God. And the scripture says, he went away grieving because he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said, how hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. And Jesus said, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. Verse 25, he says, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. And now I have questions. I want to close, but I have a few questions because that's a big statement. Is Jesus saying that wealthy people can't get into heaven? I don't think so. It seems like none of us can get our way into heaven by what we do or what we have. But is Jesus saying that it's harder for wealthy people to get in? I don't know, maybe. I wasn't there. It seems like maybe as he tells this rich young ruler and his disciples multiple times, that how hard it is for the rich to get into heaven, it's easier for a camel. You know, how hard is it for anyone to get into heaven? But he keeps bringing up this possessions, this riches, as something that kind of keeps us from it. And so maybe the more we play this game, the more we play Monopoly, the more we play the things of this world, the rules, play by the rules, and stay in this kind of very materialistic culture, maybe the more we play, the more we have at stake, the more we work to increase and keep those things, the more energy and time we spend on the things of this world, on our house or on our job, maybe the more we have, the more focus it does take. Maybe sometimes the things we own does own us. And maybe it does take us away from God a little bit. And I know this from firsthand experience. I'm closing, but I want to admit that I know this from firsthand experience because I just got a house. It's overwhelming. It's a lot to do. It's a lot of energy and attention that it takes from me. And I can't be focused and consumed on one thing. And I can't really be fixing the lock heater and reading scripture. I could probably fix the lock heater and pray at the same time, which would be good. I encourage us all to be praying. But I really do think that sometimes you kind of have to choose. You have to set your mind on how am I going to spend my day? How am I going to spend my attention? In Matthew 6:19, Jesus tells us, "Don't store up for yourself treasures in heaven, where moths and vermin destroy, where things break in and steal, but store up for yourself treasures in heaven." Sorry, not in earth, in heaven. "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." So where is our attention? Where is our heart? Where have we stored up our treasure? In Matthew 6, in verse 24, Jesus reminds us, "No one can serve two masters." Just like the sermon title, I want us to remember this. It says, "No one can serve two masters," this is Jesus speaking, "either you will hate the one and love the other, or you will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money." He says it pretty clearly. You cannot serve both God and money. Some translations, you know, have it. You cannot serve God and mammon. And mammon is translated as the treasure a person trusts in. You cannot serve God and also serve that treasure that you've stored up that isn't God. So, who do we serve? What do we trust in? Are we playing the money game or the Jesus game? Are we trying to juggle both? Have we decided, God, you have it all. You take it all. You figure my life out, my finances out, my time out. I want to be serving you in everything I have and everything I do. Do we need to sell everything we have? Do I need to sell the house that I just have? I mean, maybe. That's exactly what Jesus told this man to do. But there's also the possibility that Jesus doesn't want us to just give money and think that we have got it. Maybe Jesus is just asking us to serve what is important. Or maybe he's asking us to do both, right? Let go of all this extra that we have and serve what's important. Put our money where our mouth is and start truly living just for Jesus. Two more pages. If God is speaking to you in this way, if he's saying, give up your stuff, give up this, give up that. I don't know what your life between God and you is, but if he's saying that, just do it. It's not worth any time or energy spent away from God. But Jesus reminds us that only God saves us. In Mark 10, verse 26, the disciples asked him, "Who then can be saved?" And he says, "For mortals it's impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Praise God. For God, all things are possible. It's okay that I don't have the answer. Sorry if I'm not really sorry if I've stirred up stuff for you, having my job, but I don't have the answer, and God does have the answer. Open yourself to God. Have a conversation with God about where your heart is, where your time is, what you're doing with your money or not doing. It's not about you talking to me. Have a conversation with God, because Jesus says, for mortals, all of this is impossible, but God, with God, all things are possible. So ultimately, the question is, who do we serve? Are we trying to serve mortals? Are we trying to serve ourselves? Or are we trying to serve God? Where is our heart? So your assignment this week is to challenge yourself to take a break every hour and pray. Right? If we're really trying to make this switch from being so in the world, from being so focused on our house or finances or whatever, our school or job, if we're trying to do this, how do we start? What do we do? Well, let's take time every hour. Let's take time in the day to just center ourselves and say, God, where are you? What are you doing? God, how can I serve you? And I think I've come up with, I haven't come up with it, but I use the spiritual discipline of a phone alarm, where I set my alarm every hour to pop up and annoy me and say, question, God, where are you? Or God, how can I serve you? Or just set your kitchen table alarm or something every hour to ring, and you'll know, oh, let me take a second, let me pray, let me see where God's at. Let me focus on who I'm really serving. So try it. I challenge you to put on your phone an alarm 3 or 5 times a day. And then when it rings, stop what you're doing. Stop and connect with God. That's the assignment. I will be checking this homework, so please make sure it's done. I can't check. God. So let's pray together. Let's pray. Lord, you have full access to all of my bank accounts. You get it all, God. And most of all, you have full access to all of my heart. I want to serve you, God. I want to serve you and you alone, with my attention, with my energy. Please, Lord, remove everything in my life that takes me away from serving you, from your presence. All the distractions in my life, God, that keep me busy, not focused on the ways that you're moving in this world, God, take it away from me. Remove it, God. It's hard to be rich because there's so much to distract me from you, God, and so I give you everything. I don't want to hold on to the things of this world, Lord. I want you. Please, Lord, I give you everything. Only let me just please feel your presence with me. Let me keep you, let me hold you, let me stay focused on you. Thank you, God. We love you, Lord. Help us to figure this out together. Help us to feel your presence. Help us to serve you. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
repeat the benediction. Jesus, be with us. Holy Spirit, be with us. Fall afresh on this place, Holy Spirit. God, we declare that we go forth from this place in the power of your name, Jesus, not fearing anything, not being afraid or worried about anything. We are marked by your blood. And we also declare that we go from this place with peace. Jesus, help the things that have been unsettled, Lord. Speak to them, God, and help us to be settled. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.